Welcome to the first Sunday Spy Show podcast from Spies and Shadows TV here in the UK. My name is Brian Gray.
And I'm Chris Carr.
And together, we'll be discussing the latest news from the intelligence world, especially from the UK. We'll also be reviewing current and classic books written about the spy world, both factual and fiction, as well as passing judgment on the latest spy cinema and TV, as well as some from further back in time. In short, it's a smorgasbord of spying and skullduggery. For those of you listening on YouTube or have downloaded it elsewhere and are wondering who on earth we are, we'd better reveal ourselves. Well, first of all, my name's Brian Gray. I'm the owner and the guide of the Intelligence Trail. That's London's in-depth spy tour, which has been on the go since 2009. Also a writer and consultant in other areas as well. And so I'm one half of Spies and Shadows TV. And as for Chris...
Hello there. Yeah, so my name's Chris Carr. I am by trade a filmmaker. I've just recently written and directed a short spy film called The Dry Cleaner. And I'm hoping this will be the kind of beginning of bigger things with spy films and stuff. I've been a spy buff, I suppose, the best way to describe it, most of my life. I've been very lucky to meet a few former spies, Oleg Gordievsky being one of them. Maybe I've met a few spies unknowingly as well. Wouldn't surprise me. I've always had taken an active interest in espionage and read as many books as I can when I have time. And it just, I don't know, it's just a topic I keep revisiting and slightly obsess over. And the thing is now, spying has become such a big issue now. And we'll go into that with some of the surveillance bill stuff and things like that. So spying is incredibly topical, and probably more topical now than it ever has been, I think.
Absolutely. I probably should say actually how the two of us met. I was actually commissioned by the PR company who's responsible for the recent The Man from U.N.C.L.E. Movie. So I was doing a tour as a Cold War, trying to fit around about the 50s and 60s when the movie was set, which isn't hard in London. There was a whole bunch of sort of locations which fit nicely into that. And Chris was one of the few lucky chaps invited onto the tour, and very quickly realised that evening that he obviously knew a thing or two more than pretty much everyone else in the room, probably combined. With the exception of myself, perhaps.
Yes.
But in terms of the people who were invited, we sort of kept in contact after that and thought, I think there's legs in this to sort of combine our talents and put something useful. That's the grand intention, certainly. So now you know who the podcast protagonists are. Shall we head on to the news?
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it.
Right. The news. Really, this week, I suppose we could go into the last of the four letters, but really, it's really sort of three letters. IPA. And that's not India Pale Ale for all you drinkers out there, but the Investigatory, can't even say it. I've not been drinking honest. The Investigatory Powers Act.
Not too much the other IPA.
I think I have been on India Pale Ale.
Good stuff.
This has been drafted up, and it's if you want to go onto the internet, and you can go onto the gov.uk, you can actually download it. It's 299 pages long. Great bedtime reading. Probably not. But I did get a quick glimpse of it, and yes, there are flowcharts and examples of where surveillance might be required. Mm-hmm. Best British government tradition. Pinch of salt. So you can knock yourself out by reading that. However, There are easier ways. The Guardian's been quite good with its coverage in terms of the key points of it all. But yeah, there's been various articles, you know, no shortage of them really, in the last week or so, as I think it's been a mixture of the intelligence services trying to, you know, do the whole sort of PR angle and get sort of find some amiable, friendly journals. A bit of journal fluffing. That sounds very, very bad, isn't it? you know, friendly sort of journalists who sort of put their side across. Then there's the more, I'd say, maybe objective, conscientious, perhaps, journalists who've put their own, you know, very independent thoughts on paper, rather online, about it. So there's a mixture here of the, you know, with the journal fluff and the more independent sort of stuff. One of the, I don't know, we could probably have a, we've got a whole pile of of all sort of the articles about it. I mean, we had, first of all, one of the first ones I saw was a few days ago in The Guardian on the, actually, last day of October, 31st October, but written by Henry Porter, "Don't be fooled by spook propaganda. The state still wants license to pry." And this, and Henry Porter isn't alone. There's quite a few people who thought, isn't it funny that this bill is being sort of announced and all of a sudden GCHQ and MI6 and MI5 are all sort of talking to journalists right at the same time when Spectre is being sort of, you know, released around the world in cinemas. You know, there's a fair few sort of maybe more cynical people sort of saying, this doesn't, you know, this doesn't smack of anything smelly, does it?
I do wonder, I don't think it's, I don't know, I'm always sceptical about that scepticism as well. I don't know if it's that well coordinated, but it's certainly, I know, like, every time a Bond movie comes out, you always get a certain level of spies telling us about what life in MI6 is like and things like that. So I don't know how well coordinated it is, but it's certainly interesting timing, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, there's also a big sort of disconnect, because people were always at pains to say, oh, it's not, you know, life in MI6 isn't about sort of, you know, storming into embassies, driving Aston Martins, you know, all that sort of stuff. Yet, when you went back, certainly into the, you know, a few decades ago, Colin McCall, former MI6 chief, said James Bond is our best recruiting sergeant.
Yeah.
So it's almost like they want the attention of Bond. Ah, right, okay, so here's Bond, MI6. Mm. So get the, if you like, in marketing terms, the category demand.
Yeah.
Build that up. But then once people are interested, oh, by the way, you probably have heard about us from Bond. Oh, we're actually nothing like him.
Yeah, they do go to great pains. And even recently, actually, there's been some articles, and I think there's some we'll probably even go into, about how James Bond is definitely not the type of guy they want. Because spying, from, I suppose, what we know about it, from what we've read, is very much a team effort. And it's much more... And the thing I like and find interesting about spying from a fictional point of view is it boils down to two people in a room a lot of the time. And it's very psychological. And it very rarely involves people blowing stuff up, shooting people and things like that. Not that that doesn't happen, and as we see with drones and stuff like that, there is a lot of blowing up and assassination going on, probably much more openly now than ever before in some respects, but yeah.
Yeah, it's all very interesting. So we had, I think, in the Guardian, another article in The Guardian, talking about sort of the Bond thing, Marina Hyde.
Oh, yes, on this one made me laugh.
James Bond's got a license to shill. Snooper's charter. 007 is back, and so with spytastic synchronicity between cinema and state, is a GCHQ publicity drive. Snowden, Astica, and the fourth nipple will have to wait.
Yeah.
Scaramanga's been outdone. But yeah, she sort of mentions the draft Investigatory Powers Bill. And what the phrase that, the two words that really sort of caught my eye, don't make any assumptions based on this, she described the PR campaign as mutually masturbatorial. I thought, oh, that dear. Is still worth a tweet.
I will.
Highlighting that article.
I did want to bring a few things up about this article, because this is one of those very... Every time a Bond movie comes out, you get one of those sort of... Well, I'll call it an anti-Bond puff piece. Or it's clickbait, I don't know. So this particular article kind of smacked at that a little bit. I don't think she's seen the film. I'll be surprised she had, because Spectre, not trying to give away too much, is probably the most pro... Snowden, an anti-surveillance Bond film ever made. It sort of pretty much says old school spying good, modern surveillance spying bad. That is pretty much what that film says. So I'd be greatly surprised if she'd seen this movie, because if she has, I don't think she would have necessarily written this article. But and another interesting fact, actually, as well, the Bond producers actually own the rights and are developing the film version of Glenn Greenwald's Snowden book, No Place to Hide. So they're not, definitely don't have an official relationship with the government, because why would they be making the Snowden movie? Because, you know, and also the Sony email hacks that happened would have surely have revealed some dodgy relationship between the government and the production team behind Spectre, because so much information came out, and the only thing that did kind of come out of note was some of the criticisms around the third act of the film, which I read and I agree with. But the you know, a relationship definitely would have come out through that email thing. And we know through WikiLeaks and all the other things that the government definitely do use email, and they do write things they really shouldn't. As Hillary Clinton found out back in, was it 2009, when the diplomatic emails came out? I can't remember now, but it was a while back. But so the government always get caught out on emails, as do Sony executives as well.
And not using the proper servers.
Hillary. Yeah, yeah, exactly. So
it's like Basil Fawlty, let's not mention the war. It's like, let's not mention Benghazi.
So I think License to the Shield is License to Clickbait, or License to be anti-Bond, in my opinion. But
yeah. One of the things that I actually found in, you know, a couple of articles is something that something at GCHQ, one of our, you know, our anonymous spokespeople, sort of said when you're talking about the, you know, the whole sort of privacy snooping surveillance sort of thing. He said, if the internet is being used to sell you things, he or she inquired rhetorically of the Times, why is it wrong for little GCHQ to use a tiny bit of the data to stop you being blown up on holiday? I kind of took umbrage at this, because it's not the same thing. You know, you generally can't sort of have a dialogue with GCHQ saying, well, actually, I don't mind you having a look at this, but I do mind you having a look at that. You know, you don't have any say in that. Whereas if they're talking about, you know, selling you things on the internet, that's because consumers have voluntarily decided to enter into, you know, a relationship, you know, engage with these companies.
One point on that, though, about the corporate side of things, it's a lot of companies sell on your data, and I don't know necessarily if people, I mean, it's probably in the terms and conditions. So Facebook's a good example. I'm sure in the terms and conditions, if anybody ever reads them on Facebook, tells you that, hey, we sell your habits to companies. And they do. And they've also used it for psychological studies and all sorts of things. Now, I must admit, I mean,
assuming you know the T's and C's, you can still decide whether or not you still want to engage with that company or not.
The problem is, though, with the Facebook example, the only way you could say no is by leaving Facebook.
And but it's still a choice.
Yeah, but then it cuts you off. Because, I mean, and this is another big thing, actually, with technology and the internet. It's so much part of our lives now, professionally speaking as well. Like, for me, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn are pretty essential to my getting work. And so I think it's in some ways unfair that you either have the choice of being on it or not. There should be a box that you can tick that turns your account into one that can't be used for this, so you can opt out, shall we say, but not have a dramatic consequence. Because the thing is as well, like, every website I go on that's from America, I have to, if I want to look at the website, I have to consent to their cookie consent thing. And I've never said no, but I'm assuming if I say no, it will restrict my access to the website, or it will affect the way I interact with it. So it's a bit like, it's a bit one-sided, the corporate thing too. Even though, yeah, I have a choice of whether to go on the website, but I don't really have a choice. It's either I could look at it or I can't. That's not much of a choice. So it's a bit of a...
But I mean, right, yeah. I mean, with Vodafone, you know, if I wanted to have a, you know, get a mobile phone,
yeah,
with, you know, Vodafone or, you know, any sort of company, that's, initially, that's a choice I make.
Yes.
Whereas with GCHQ, so, I mean, you're not going to get an opt-in box somewhere or whatever. Do you consent to GCHQ having a look at your, you know, yeah, you're not going to have that. No. So there is a difference, but...
Well, what,
I think it's a very good point.
Yeah, funny thing as well, actually. One thing phone companies do, in defence of them, because I used to work for one, disclaimer, on your contract, you have an option to opt out of having your details sold on to marketing companies. That, I think, is a good practice, because it doesn't affect, like, the way your phone works. You're just saying, no, I don't want my data sold on. Unfortunately, I forgot to tick that box, and I get harassed by PPI people now, frequently. So my fault.
Is there anyone that doesn't get harassed by that?
I know. God.
I know. I mean, there's so many different dimensions, I think, to this whole sort of Investigatory Powers Act. There's a very straightforward government, you know, or intelligence agency surveillance, mass collection, that sort of thing. But it also, as we've just discussed, it also raises the relationship of that side of things, but also the corporate side as well. It's, you know, I say we could talk about this for ages. One thing that I did see, which is quite, I'm not sure quite refreshing, but certainly sort of gave hope, it was in the Telegraph, again, last day of October, Tim Ross, Theresa May set for clash with Dominic Grieve over new spy laws. Theresa May is the Home Secretary. Dominic Grieve is the fairly recently appointed chair of the Intelligence and Security Committee.
Yeah.
Effectively, or supposedly, the, you know, the watchdog, if you like, looking over the affairs of MI5, MI6, GCHQ. And Dominic Grieve is actually, maybe not trying to curtail Theresa May, but certainly sort of bringing to people's attention that the whole sort of way of getting warrants, authorization, who does what, could be, you know, perhaps improved. You know, as Tim Ross is saying, Theresa May is heading for a dramatic confrontation of Parliament's official intelligence watchdog over sweeping new powers for spies. The policy is likely to require mobile phone and internet companies to store web browsing and email records of all their customers for at least 1 year.
Because they currently store it for 6 months, don't they? Is that right?
Sorry?
Do they currently store data for 6 months?
I'm not sure. I think it's just actually saying, look, we're allowed to do this now.
Yeah. I don't know. I was under the impression they do store it at the moment, but for a certain fixed period, it's either 3 or 6 months, but I could be wrong. But, you know.
But yeah, Home Secretary, she generally, you know, they generally have the final say in terms of like signing off sort of warrants for the taps and interceptions, that sort of thing. But Dominic Grieve is not sort of coming out and saying, oh no, this is all sort of rubbish, I think. You know, far from it. He said, you know, the agencies need these powers, but there must be safeguards to try to make sure those powers are not being abused.
Yeah.
Which I think it's quite refreshing, because normally, you know, your typical sort of politicians, civil servants, whatever, they've always just sort of said, oh, you know, we don't really sort of question, we don't want to sort of rock the boat. You know, they will generally be appointed for being, and I quote, you know, sort of a safe pair of hands. That's the thing. Yet here's somebody, I mean, Dominic Grieve was the former Attorney General for about 4 years, David Cameron's you know, coalition's sort of cabinet. Grieve is suggesting that judges may be better placed than ministers to authorise the communications interceptions, and that would arguably help improve public confidence that there's no abuse from the services.
Yeah, well, I think that's the key point, isn't it? Public confidence, because this is an issue of trust, isn't it? Because especially in light of like the Snowden revelations, all that kind of stuff, I think right now, And maybe it feels like certainly post 9/11 and stuff, trust is a massive issue. We don't seem to trust our politicians much anymore for all sorts of reasons, from, you know, various scandals over the years, especially recent, well, a few years back, the expenses scandal was one massive one, wasn't it? You know, and politicians do feel like this sort of out of touch, otherworldly beings that kind of can totally affect our lives. And public confidence seems to be very low these days. With regards to politics,
I think it's also the fact that, you know, there's that culture now of mistrust. I mean, so many people, and I think maybe in Scotland that was one reason why, so, you know, perhaps the SNP did well. We're going off topic, you know, more on positive, was this, we just seemed to, you know, a lot of the candidates were rather different to your typical Westminster politician, because it didn't matter whether you're conservative, you know, Lib Dem, Labour, you know, you're all to a certain amount tagged with the same brush. Oh yeah, you're going to try and fiddle your expenses, you know, you're going to be, you know, not perhaps representing your constituents' views, blah, blah. And so there's that sort of side of things in terms of trusting the politicians. But also I think it's when the activities of the intelligence services are so... you're not able to scrutinise them in the way that you would, you know, a PLC or a limited company, and there's good reasons for that. But when there is that lack of transparency or whatever, we have to place far more trust in those agencies on just blind trust. And when we find out that things have gone wrong over the years, such as Iraq or the Gareth Williams affair, and whenever we smell something really dodgy, that sort of breakdown of trust is almost, you know, amplified.
And I think that's a big issue. And I think actually the Iraq war is probably one of the single most damaging things that we've ever done, and it's eroded so much trust, because Tony Blair and George Bush, the way they acted, and eventually the Chilton Inquiry might well come to a conclusion. I hear it's at the Crimean War at the moment, but but it's just done so much damage to trust. And only now I think Tony Blair begrudgingly is apologising for it slightly. You know, and it's just like, And I think back on the politician thing for a minute, because it's quite interesting. We're in a world now where the rise of the unpolished politician. So Nigel Farage, Jeremy Corbyn, and then in the States Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders. It's quite. We seem to want people a bit unedited now, don't we? And a little bit making gaffes here and there. It makes them feel more real.
But rather, it was a genuine person rather than a polished, polished person who spent years as a, you know, background policy gonk. Rather than sort of being out with real people.
No, exactly. And I don't know. I'm always in two minds about those kind of people, because I don't think in certain cases it's an act. I think some people it totally is an act, but. I don't know. I like a sense of competence in a politician. If somebody's running the country, you know, and so, yeah, traditionally, like in the US, a lot of people who end up being successful to become the president come from a legal background, typically, like Obama's from a legal background, isn't he? Obviously, occasionally you get the odd one like Ronald Reagan, who was a former actor, but Reagan was very, from my understanding, was still very active in politics and things, and stood up for a lot of positive things as well as negative things too. So it's, I don't know. It's an interesting one. Sorry, a bit of a tangent there, but...
Now, I mean, what I also found interesting was that I think it was Grieve was almost sort of, I guess, sort of making his claim or sort of, you know, making his mark, because previously the ISC was chaired by Malcolm Rifkind, before he stepped down.
And the ISC, we probably better point out what the ISC is, just in case there are some people who don't know what the ISC is.
The Intelligence and Security Committee. It's a select committee in Parliament, which oversees the activities of MI5, MI6 and GCHQ.
Yeah.
Now, they had sort of said, they'd sort of agreed in the committee back in March, ministers should keep the power to authorise warrants, and, you know, there was no call for judges or anything like that. And Grieve has said, I have no doubt that the present committee may well want to look at that issue. The present committee is not necessarily totally tied to recommendations made by the earlier committee.
Yeah.
Now, you could, I guess it depends on the viewpoint. You could sort of say, well, he's just sort of, you know, saying that it's quite sort of, you know, it's an open topic. We're not necessarily tied to what was agreed, you know, earlier. Or you could sort of say, well, from a personal point of view, maybe this is Grieve making his mark, stamping his authority, sort of, you know, making his, I guess, sort of, yeah, shoving his flag post, you know, into the earth and saying, look, here's me. This is what the ISC are about, and you know, it's let's see where. You know, where this all goes. We're not going to be sort of tied just to something that's maybe sort of agreed, you know, a few months earlier by somebody else in charge.
Yeah, because the bill's going through in the new year, isn't it? So it's going to go through to, you know, both parts of Parliament. And I'm assuming, you know, so we'll see how it develops. I suppose is this a good time to write to your local MP and express your concerns about it, isn't it? Because they're going to have to debate this. And so I suppose if anybody is concerned about it, I think they should. One other thing as well, actually, Liberty, who are kind of are they an NGO? Is that the best way to describe them? They advocate for privacy and things like that. They created this sort of, they've got a campaign going on about an 8-point plan. Should I quickly read the 8-point plan? It's just like, it's judicial. It's a point one, judicial sign off. Number two is respect for our data. Number three, targeted surveillance for reason. Number four, transparency and redress. Number five, use of intercept evidence in court. Six, fair, open international data sharing laws. Seven, protect our encryption standards. Number eight is recognition of the unique threat that hacking poses to our security. So within these 8-point plan, they go into detail on certain things. Now, one of the big topics is obviously encryption, because since the Snowden revelations, encryption's come up a lot. And I'm in two minds about this encryption thing, because on one part, yes, you want to be able to have a certain level of encryption that protects us against criminals, what have you. But at the same time, if encryption's too good, said criminals could be using it to plan whatever they want to do as well. So it's a difficult one. But from what I understand of some of the Snowden reporting, it is alleged that the NSA had a relationship with, you know, technology companies and would leave little back doors into the encryption. And the thing is, so that was the government that had that, and it's not on the civilian market. Now, I could kind of, I don't totally object to that, because obviously I think the government do need some sort of way to monitor these things, because, like, you know, if somebody's plotting something and they're using BlackBerry Messenger or something that's heavily encrypted to say, right, we're going to put a bomb here at this time, you would hope that the government had the technology to kind of detect that. But I think most terrorists today are using more old school methods of communication, aren't they? I think, like, Bin Laden was reliant on couriers, wasn't he? He was, and I think that's in the end how they found him. He was more the sort of person to write a letter and get a personal courier he trusted to deliver that letter.
I think that actually came about. I read that he was using a satellite phone, and then an American, I think it was like either CIA or some, you know, aide or, you know, spokesman, whatever, let slip that the Americans had been listening to his phone calls.
Yeah.
And that was somehow out in the open. And as soon as that sort of was heard back in the Middle East, Bin Laden dropped his sat phone, you know, like the proverbial hot potato. And, you know, I thought, right, let's ditch the technology. It's too easy to track.
Yeah.
But what? It's another issue, is that It was actually a comment on one of the articles that I was reading online, and somebody said, you know, if everyone's saying like Spies and GCHQ, you know, the terrorists are getting cleverer and cleverer, and we've got to, you know, we've got to have this increased capability. Somebody said, well, if they're becoming cleverer and cleverer, then, you know, surely they'll just start, rather than sort of having, you know, requiring bulk data collection, if the terrorists are using VPNs, then you're not going to see this anyway. But so why bother with sort of all this huge bulk collection if the bad guys are probably not, you know, not using that, but using their own VPN?
Yeah, I suppose the other thing, traditionally signals intelligence, which is what this is sort of known as, isn't it, also applies to military stuff as well. There used to be a system called Echelon that would monitor all electronic communication across. They said it was across Europe. I think this is where the Five Eyes things come in, isn't it? Because you need then the other stations to monitor across the world.
You have Australia, you have New Zealand, you have Canada, you have you know, the States and the GCHQ. GCHQ, I think, was generally responsible for all of Western Europe, pretty much up to the Urals, and also Middle East, North Africa.
Yeah.
That's generally the GCHQ's patch.
Yeah, and so they were looking for keywords and things like that. And well, actually, one thought that's just come into my mind is, the thing is as well, what's interesting is we know all about the Western capability, but what we don't know about is everybody else's capability. Because the thing is, I'm pretty certain Russia and China and other countries probably have very similar efforts going on. I know, like in Edward Lucas's book, The New Cold War, I think he makes a mention of a particular site, for life I can't remember it, but there's a particular Russian site that monitors European communication. So the so I've got two kind of things. Number one is then, how are other people using our data? What do we know about them? And number two, all the data that is amassed, where is it stored? Because the thing is, if somebody like, I don't know, a terrorist hacker or even a state-sponsored hacker hacks into wherever the government's storing all our personal surveyed information, what then? You know, does that mean like individual kind of online habits could then potentially be used against the businessman when he goes to China next, unbeknown to him? He could get a visit in his hotel room one evening. And somebody could say, and could probably use that information to blackmail them. But, you know,
I remember, it was actually a few weeks ago when the whole, the hacking of the website Ashley Madison.
Oh, yes.
And MI6 were going through that, to see if they could potentially have a go at some people, but also to see, are any of our lot, are any Brits, in rather centred positions, are they potentially a threat?
Yeah.
So they were looking at it from both angles.
Yeah, I think
there's one thing which we should sort of, you know, make clear, I think. I mean, yes, this whole sort of, you know, this draft bill is very important. Some people might say, it's, you know, the squeaky clean. Yes, it's, you know, it's to protect us from terrorists. You know, it's to protect us from, you know, the criminals and everything. Mm. And the other side, there's people who see this as a truly Orwellian nightmare, you know, a digital dystopia.
Yeah.
And I think it's, you know, I think if you belong in either one of those extremes, I think you're being naive or just unrealistic.
Mm.
I think, you know, finding that sort of perfect line is going to be somewhere in the middle, because I would hate there to be unaccountable sort of Big Brother Orwellian dystopia, where your every single online movement is being tracked and stored for who knows what in the future, not just used now, but that information stored for a future government or whatever. At the same time, you know, there are bad people out there, and we're not necessarily talking about sort of, you know, authoritarian sort of, you know, governments or whatever. We're talking about criminals, fraudsters, paedophile gangs, whatever. So it's not saying, you know, it's got to be, you know, all or nothing.
Mm.
You know, even the most ardent sort of privacy supporter will be saying, well, look, I you know, I acknowledge there are bad people out there. It's not just sort of, you know, the government.
Mm.
There are bad people who will take advantage of, you know, technology.
Yeah.
So we've got to keep up. You know, it's a very, it's weird to find that line.
Well, this is it. And this is what refreshed me looking at Liberty's website yesterday. I was impressed to see they actually do acknowledge there is a need for this, because there have been, especially when the Snowden thing kicked off 2 years ago, there were quite a few people who are sort of fans of WikiLeaks and stuff like that, who are kind of arguing there should be no digital surveillance at all. And I just, I agree with you, I think it's a very naive point of view, because it's an unfortunate necessity, because bad guys do use iPhones and other things too. And until we live in a world where, I don't know, there are no bad people, which I don't think is ever going to happen, unfortunately we're going to need some degree of law enforcement to kind of keep an eye out for the greater safety of people, you know, of greater society.
Yeah, I mean, I think, personally, where I sort of come from mm. quite a while, you know, it's not, there always used to be that argument which some people would put out saying, if I've got nothing to hide, why should I bother about
yeah.
it? I think it was Edward Snowden himself who said, that's like saying, I've got nothing to say, so it shouldn't really be freedom of speech. Mm. He said something along those lines.
Yeah.
I think if you're law-abiding citizen, you shouldn't have any real objections, provided
mm.
the trust is there, the safeguarding is there, the mm. accountability
yeah.
is there.
Yeah.
And whenever there's been any, pardon my French, balls ups,
mm.
the government or the agencies can hold their hands up and you'll probably say, okay, this happened, this is what we're now going to do to safeguard it from happening again. Mm. It's that sort of area of trust and accountability, which is, I think, probably for most people actually, the big concern,
yeah.
rather than what the actual, you know, contents of the bill are
mm.
in terms of the capability.
Mm. And so it's keeping an eye on the judicial oversight, I think, is the key to getting it right, isn't it? And how they kind of handle that.
Because there's talk about, obviously, like, you know, politicians versus the judges, and, you know, where sort of the judges are seen as sort of the beacon of light. But what happens mm-hmm. if you get somebody, a judge who's, you know, meant to be looking at these warrants and things,
mm.
and you get end up with a character like, what was the judge's name? It was like years ago. And he said, you know, who is Gaza? He was so removed from reality. Do you want that kind of judge, you know, involved in this? Well, no.
No, they need to be qualified, don't they? They need to understand. Because this is the other thing as well, actually. A lot of people at the policy level, because obviously politicians get shipped from role to role, they don't always, they're more reliant on their advisors, aren't they? They don't necessarily have the knowledge themselves of the intricacies of certain things. And I know, like, when, the Snowden revelations came out, there was a lot of debate within, is it Congress in America, about, among America's politicians, about what these revelations mean and things like that. And quite a few of the people having the debate actually knew very little about the capabilities and the reasons why. And there's a lot of people who have opinions on intelligence matters who just haven't read anything but a newspaper about intelligence or yeah. watched a Bourne movie or a Bond movie. And I suppose one thing I would always say to people is always read. If you're interested in a particular topic, like this Snowden thing, there's quite a few books on signals intelligence that you can go and buy that are about it, that are more factual and based on why they do what they do. And I think people should always go and read as many books as they can on the subject, especially about espionage, things that are out of your normal day-to-day interests, because you're going to learn a lot more that way than relying on papers and politicians and anything like that. Because the spying world's quite complicated, and there's so many reasons and reasons that are totally alien to us as normal people sometimes behind why they have to do things. Like, one of the things in the Liberty points that came up, I'll just see if I can quickly find it in my notes, but that one thing that I thought that probably wasn't a wise idea, revealing techniques, sometimes you've got to be a bit careful about revealing techniques because people can evade them. So yeah. if you tell people, oh, well, I can do this, that everybody, if everybody knows that, then I mean, it's like there's a scene in The Wire, isn't there? The TV show The Wire, where the some of the gangs go to these court proceedings just so they can learn about the capabilities of how the police do their surveillance, and so then they can take counter surveillance measures for the future. So there is an argument sometimes for why you don't want to reveal all your techniques. And I know, like with the Snowden revelations, this became a massive point of concern for the NSA, rightly and wrongly. You know, there was a lot of things. There's even a lot of questions still open today about what information Snowden actually has. Because from what I understand, we only know a portion of what he may or may not have. And there might be, and there's certainly been some accusations by journalists like Edward Lucas about his sharing potential sensitive information to foreign powers. Because obviously he's now residing in Russia and he did spend time in China. And there are some questions about, did he pass on anything beyond his remit around the privacy concerns? And one extra footnote I'll add to this, just because I did want to mention this with Snowden. I'm a bit in the middle with the Snowden thing, because a lot of the popular consensus of Snowden is his sort of heroic, moral figure who's opened the door onto all sorts of wrongdoing at the NSA. But I don't think it's as clear cut as that. And I think some of the, from what I've read at the time, so a bit out of date now, but a lot of the stuff that I read at the time, there was a great American sort of podcaster and commentator and blogger called Bob Seska, who kind of did pick apart quite a few of the Snowden stories and some of the revelations. And a few things were exaggerated by Glenn Greenwald, the journalist at the time. So the headlines say one thing, but then if you go into the document, you actually find that there is something else to be, you know, that kind of contradicts the headline. But most people tend to read the headline and not the document, and they tend to be more reliant on the opinion of the journalist writing the piece than they are of the actual information themselves. So it's, I'm always a bit cautious of the Snowden stuff, but he certainly, there is a lot of information we know today that's because of him, and it's certainly created this debate that I think has been quite a healthy debate generally. Yeah. But I am still a bit 50-50 about Snowden himself. But I will say he did something, you know, in some ways what he did was very brave. I wouldn't want to put myself on the line the way he did, you know. So I don't know. We'll see. Time will tell whether he was more a Cambridge Five type person, or whether he was more of a conscientious objector, or whatever the phrase is, but you know what I mean. So it's interesting. Sorry.
It was one of the articles, second of November, I think. Yeah, Max Hastings. You can always find Max Hastings in the Daily Mail. An article: State Snooping and Why I Trust Our Spies More Than Apologists for Treachery. And again, this is a whole sort of, you know, I got around GCHQ and they told me, you know, and they showed me this, showed me that, and you know, basically sort of a bit of an opinion piece, saying, look, I'd rather have the, you know, I'd rather have the spooks that know what it's doing rather than, you know, being a bit of a criminal free-for-all. And he's not one for the undramatic. There's a couple of choice sort of bits in this article. He said, it is just possible that cross-bench critics could wreck the new measure. Were this to happen, most of us would regard it as a disaster for the safety of society. And he, yeah, he doesn't have a kind word to say about Mr. Snowden.
Was he?
there's one or two. Here we go. I recently published a book, The Secret War, about spies and code-breaking in World War II. In its last chapter, I wrote that we should all be grateful that Snowden, the modern traitor, did not work at Bletchley.
Well, this is a very interesting point. Yeah.
I know. Well, my US publisher queried this, saying that in New York, some people think he's served the cause of democracy. I responded that New Yorkers can think what they like, but Snowden has dramatically increased the risks we face while diminishing the power of the intelligence services to protect us. A man who does that fits my definition of a traitor.
What? There is.
Nice to see Max sitting on the fence there. but what I sort of thought, well, wait a minute, you know, as far as I remember, Bletchley Park, you know, he refers, you know, to Bletchley. Bletchley Park wasn't involved in the mass surveillance of ordinary citizens.
True.
Snowden I have no doubt, would have been committed to the site.
Mm.
You know,
yeah, it's a different situation.
You know, I'm anti-American or anything like that. No one has ever said that.
Mm.
So I think it's wrong for Hastings to make this, you know, should be grateful that, you know, Snowden wasn't working at Bletchley.
Mm.
I don't think that's,
yeah.
I don't think it does sort of anyone any favours.
Well, one quick thing actually on the so-called potential damage that Snowden may or may not have done. Certainly when the revelations came out, because they were the Guardian was systematically kind of releasing stories every week about another Five Eyes partner. And when it came to Australia, it suddenly heightened tensions between Australia and Indonesia. And it was heightening those tensions to a very dangerous level, those revelations. And apparently, Al-Qaeda had changed their methods of operation of communications as a result of the Snowden revelations as well. So I don't know, it's an interesting one. But I think you're right, the Bletchley is a very different kind of situation to the signals intelligence being gathered by the NSA now. But one could argue warfare has changed as well. And unfortunately, there isn't a clear identifiable army anymore. The enemy is among us. You know, it's a bit like the Cylons, you know, or whatever. They are out there somewhere. And that's certainly been the case since the Cold War and God knows what else, you know. So it's not a very new situation in some respects. People are hiding, you know, among us. They could be your neighbour. And wasn't there a funny article actually about this? We were talking about spies at the workplace.
Yeah.
Where was it? Just to bring that one up. Yeah, here we are. So the CIA released documents about how to sabotage bosses and annoy colleagues. So the people at your office who cause trouble...
The colleagues have been able to do that without any trouble or training whatsoever.
Yeah, but the CIA have actually, you know, put thought into an art of annoying your colleagues and sabotaging bosses and people with places of influence. So be warned, there could be people out there in your office place who might be not all they appear to be.
Thank the Lord for being self-employed.
Well, I just have to deal with myself every day. That's the difficult thing. So,
there's been a couple of books as well written by CIA, I guess, of former case officers or psychologists, all about how you can spot liars.
Oh yes, I've got one actually.
I think it's like Spot the Liar.
Spy the Lie is a good book, yeah. One thing I remember from it actually, so apparently if somebody's lying to you, so if you ask them a direct question about did you steal such and such thing, if they don't immediately come back and deny it, so they don't say, no, of course I didn't steal that, but instead say something like, well, I'm a Christian, of course I would never steal anything. The person who answered, oh, well, I'm a Christian, has deflected the answer slightly, and they're probably lying. So apparently, if you ask somebody a direct question, and they in the first sort of moment of their reply, they answer the question, they're not lying, or they're less likely to be lying. And on top of that, there's a science to lying, because people might be lying not necessarily for the reasons you think. So the person who is lying, who is the Christian in my example, might actually not be the person who stole the thing, but might know the person who did, but doesn't want to get them in trouble because maybe there's some other bigger thing going on. Maybe that person who did steal things has, I don't know, got some difficult family situation, and so they've decided that that if they get them fired, it'll make their life worse. So, you know, there's a great show, Lie to Me, with Tim Roth, that goes into all that. I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's great fun. And he plays this sort of former MI6 officer who is trained in all powers of psychology and lie detection. And he's employed by various people every week to detect if somebody's lying or not. And the way the episodes are structured, there's usually a lie that hides another lie that's something else. There's a bigger lie going on usually. And it's great fun. It's a great show. And, you know, and I try and my best sometimes to scrutinise. I wish I was a good lie detector, but I'm not.
I'm looking at it, I think we've pretty much covered everything about the investigatory powers.
We
currently Snowden. We've got about 101 things into that. We should probably move away from the news, but
we should.
Last thing, you know, after all sort of, you know, the you know, the Investigatory Powers Act and things like that, which will be ongoing, I'm sure, for, you know, every week. I mean, it's not going to disappear, so there'll be plenty of opportunity to revisit that and to discuss the latest things on a week-by-week basis, I'm sure. But let's finally get back down to, you know, the proper enjoyable stuff. Let's talk about sex.
Hey.
you can always rely on the Daily Star to reveal that China's sexy spies a big threat as MI6 fear honey trap.
Yeah.
This is on the 1st of November. Yes, intelligence chiefs have told Prime Minister David Cameron that Chinese spies now pose a greater threat to national security than the Islamic State terror group.
Yeah.
Nothing like a dramatic sort of opening sentence there. It says Chinese spies are now aggressively targeting members of the British intelligence services and their families. Their particular focus is on former officials with ongoing business or social interests in mainland China and Hong Kong, notably those who travel there regularly. Our source, best tabloid writing here, our source, said...
Is it the Daily Star, is it?
Sorry?
Is it the Daily Star, isn't it?
Yeah. Our source said... Now, don't laugh. Our source... Well, at least try and stifle it. Our source said Chinese spies are still using a good old-fashioned honey trap to get secrets out of middle-aged businessmen and government officials. The Chinese spy network has hundreds of beautiful women who tempt lonely men into bed, offer them great sex, then engage in pillow talk. If that doesn't work, they will also use blackmail.
Well, if you ever go on holiday to China, you have to pose as an MI6 officer, and I suppose you'll get lucky. Is that what they're saying?
It's a cracking idea, though.
But do you know who fell victim to this? So I did a little bit of digging. So my source, The Mirror, in 2009, apparently Boris Johnson's deputy, Ian Clement, was a victim of a honey trap when at the Olympics. And he basically went to his room with an attractive young lady and then was somehow drugged. And then woke up and found his entire room had been trashed, and his documents were all over the place. His BlackBerry had been used. I don't think he got lucky because he'd been drugged, but he certainly had all his information taken from him. And he held it back for a while of embarrassment, and then revealed it to Boris Johnson and the intelligence services. And he had been warned before he went out by MI6. He'd been briefed to watch out for this, but still fell victim to it. And this morning, I found a video made by the FBI. Now, it's not so much about honey traps, but it is about the dangers of being an international student in China. And how, so the story of this video that's been made by the FBI, and it's very well made, it's Hollywood standard, you know, it's a really well made drama that lasts about half an hour, and it's all about this American student who's gone out to China to study and then ends up writing for this sort of Chinese, what appears to be kind of like a Chinese paper interested in American-Chinese relations, and he starts getting cash payments, and then it slowly gets worse and worse and worse, and then they recommend one day, oh, you should try the State Department, oh, you should try and join the CIA. And then he gets caught out at the... Sorry, I'm ruining the film now. But he gets caught out at the CIA because the CIA do polygraphs, or flutter, as they call it. They flutter people. And in one of the questions, have you ever been worked for or approached by a foreign government? Obviously, he got the answer wrong. And it was like, ooh. And then it turned out that he'd been spied upon by the FBI the whole time. So and he went down for 4 years. So be warned.
What I had to sort of have a bit of a guffaw about with this article in the Daily Star. I don't know if it's like one of these. Do you think we're thinking right? Okay, the Investigatory Towers, the IPA. I'm going to stop saying this.
Yeah.
The Investigatory Powers Act. I've still got it wrong. It's maybe a bit sort of, you know, it's been covered by everyone else.
Yeah.
So what do our readers want? Sex.
Yeah.
Right, let's sort of, you know, have something different. Now, having a look at this, now don't get me wrong, the main sort of image is of I assume it's a woman, with a very sort of tight sort of leather sort of bodice and a very, very tightly, pretty much spray-on leather skirt, with a gun in her hand, yeah. And so I think some latex gloves as well. Very aesthetic.
So is this how Chinese spies walk around? Do they get spot them from when you're on holiday in China and you're looking to kind of get lucky? Is this who you're supposed to chat up in a bar? Excuse me, madam. I work for MI6. Should I go upstairs?
Yeah. And there's this sort of guy with a, the picture's just incredible. So you've got this sort of very sexy looking sort of leather clad, sort of tightly skirted, lovely lady. And a man, topless, sitting on the sofa, clutching a briefcase and sort of looking at, raising his sunglasses. And I thought, yeah, that really sort of, that sort of illustrates the story.
Yeah.
But then, when you go further down, now they have the pillow talk sort of picture.
Yeah.
So there's two, there's a couple, man and woman, on the bed, and I'm not even sure if it's the same guy, I think it might be. And he's sort of topless, you just see sort of his torso and his, bare arms and stuff. The woman is on the bed, she's sort of more scantily clothed, but like a dress or something. None of them look oriental at all. We're talking about Chinese sexy spies. So it's obviously sort of highly accurate, sort of, right, let's get to the picture library. What sort of pictures can we look at? We've got, two people on a bed. That's Chinese sexy, and that'll work,
And it's on their browsing history now as well, so.
But it's like my Mr. Angry. It's like, I almost own the hashtag sack the intern. When there's nothing worse to me than when you have like news websites or whatever, and they just find some sort of library picture where it's completely either wrong or doesn't actually convey anything about the story. I mean, one of the things is even the Evening Standard just a few days ago when there was the horrible Russian aircraft blowing up. Which I think in mid-air. And it was an Airbus A321. And what does the Evening Standard show? Oh, it's a picture of a Boeing 747.
Oh, I know. It's so stupid, isn't it?
It annoys me.
Yeah.
It's like, well, what sort of work went into getting, that picture? Mm. Presumably the writer or whoever knows it's an A321. Does he then sort of, get an intern to sort of, find us an A321? And some intern thinks, oh, this will do.
It's a plane, I was surprised they didn't get, like, Amelia Earhart in a biplane.
I know, it's one of my rants.
Yeah.
It's probably a feature.
I've had similar rants.
Journalistic or intern ignorance.
It also happens in movies too, like continuity errors. And this is one of my fun ones. In I think it was an episode of Spooks once. It was. It was in series 6. I'm trying to remember exactly which episode it was now, but it was the one where they talk about
series six.
They
25 minutes in.
Yeah, they talk about the Aurora project. There's an episode that has like UFO-ness to it. It was a bit of a departure for Spooks, but anyway. So they have this helicopter, and the first helicopter is an Aerospatiale AS-355. And yes, I am that geeky. And then they kind of cut to another shot, the same helicopter, and it's a completely different helicopter. It's now Robinson R-22. And then they cut back to the Aerospatiale, and it's like these helicopters look so different. How on earth does anybody cut them together? And it's a simple, they do it all the time, and they do it with guns, they do it with so many things. It's not just Spooks, so many programs do this. And it's just like, what on earth? And some of it, now with guns, because they're props, it's sometimes what it is, they shoot the scenes out of sequence. So like week one, they're over, like in one of the Bourne films, I think it's the last one, because the second and the third were so similar, I'd lose track which one it was. But there's a bit where Bourne is confronting the guy who has the key to all the stuff about his life. And in over Jason Bourne's shoulder, I think he's holding a Glock. But then when he go over the other guy's shoulder, he's holding a 6-hour, which are two totally different kinds of guns. And it's like, what is going on? So I think the reality is they probably shot those scenes weeks apart. And somebody wasn't doing their job on continuity. And then they just don't know. And to most people, a gun looks like a gun, a helicopter looks like a helicopter, and a plane looks like a plane, you know, and it's like, well, anyway, sorry, totally geeky. So that's my rant on the same subject, but it's like...
Yeah, no, I just get the red mist.
Yeah.
It's just like, sack the intern. You know, I mean, whatever happened to just actually sort of, you know, taking the time to work out what was really required.
Yeah.
It's either a case of ignorance or cost-cutting, no, we don't have time to get it right, one, just find the first picture you can find. Or we just think we treat the readers or the viewers like absolute mugs.
Yeah.
It's somewhere in the
between all that, yeah.
Yeah, anyway, do you think that pretty much covers the news?
It does. I think we've definitely covered the news.
I mean, we've covered everything.
I mean, there actually are more stories we could go into, but we just don't have... We could be here all week, so... And I kept my... I've kept my browser open just in case anything popped up. And at the moment, the only thing that's current today is the talk about the unfortunate, you know, the terrible Russian airline crash and whether it's a bomb or not. Now, I think the Prime Minister has come out, as in our Prime Minister, David Cameron. Sorry, I didn't say Tony Blair there. God. David Cameron. I think he's pretty much said that it was a bomb, and it's led to this huge investigation over in Egypt at the moment, and now they're shipping back tourists, but they're only allowed to take hand luggage, and they're concerned that there was a bomb on the plane. But the thing is, as far as we all know at the moment, it's not confirmed. And so it's obviously upset the Russian government, because we're saying, oh, it was a bomb. And it's still not really known yet. There's been no conclusive evidence either way. There was some satellite image of some sort of heat signature, and it's certainly on the black box. I think did they hear a bang or something? They heard something, but it could have been an engine blowing up. Could have been many things. So we don't know yet for sure whether it was a bomb by ISIS. And the other thing as well, the plane came from Russia, did it not, into Egypt? So why is the focus in Egypt about the bomb? Because surely it came in from Russia. So somebody smuggled it on the plane in Moscow or wherever it took off from. So really, shouldn't the focus be on airport security there rather than Egypt? But anyway, what do I know? I don't know. So there we are. So that's just the most relevant thing that's happening in real time as we speak. But
yeah.
And maybe by the time it's broadcast, I actually know whether it's a bomb or not. But anyway.
So I think that pretty much, I think, sort of covers the news over the last 7 days in the intelligence world. As I say, there will be more to come on the IPA for, well, probably all eternity. Certainly until it goes into the Lords and the Commons for voting. There's going to be a lot of, I think, talk about it. There's going to be, I'm sure, MPs' post bags are going to be... I think considerably fuller. I think there'll be a lot of people who will try and talk to the MP about it, and, you know, either to make them, you know, to make their own opinions known. Also, I think there might be quite a few people who, you know, something we've touched upon, have maybe sort of wondered whether an MP is sufficiently sort of au fait with the issues that are the facts.
Mm.
So as all, I think it's going to be something that's, you know, as the weeks go on, there's, you know, it's not going to disappear from the media at all. So keep you posted with that each week. But don't worry, we will have more stories that don't just centre on the IPA and sort of the whole sort of surveillance thing, because there's a whole other world. And much as though some people might say, well, it's all electronic now, we saw a whole lot of tradecraft, humans, all that sort of stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
You need to, at the end of the day, you can have all the surveillance you want, but you still need boots on the ground.
Yeah.
And you still need people sort of on streets, in hotels, whatever. Hence the thing about sort of Chinese sex being asked. You know, you still need that factor.
Hotels.
anyway,
yeah.
moving swiftly onwards. So still, we're going to talk about... Spectre, and I'll leave that. You can sort of take lead on that one, Chris, given your spy film sort of background. You can sort of wax lyrical about that, and I'll sort of chip in every now and again. We also promised you a book review. I suppose, you know, spook books and spy cinema. Spook books, first one I've sort of chosen is published by Biteback Publishing in 2014. And it was Kim Philby, A Story of Friendship and Betrayal. It was written by Tim Milne, with a foreword from Philip Knightley, who's also well known for his associations with Mr. Philby. In terms of the blurb and the back cover, Ian Innes, Tim Milne, was Philby's oldest and closest friend. They studied at Westminster School together, and when Philby joined MI6, he immediately recruited Milne as his deputy. Philby's treachery was a huge blow to Milne, and after he retired, he wrote a highly revealing description of Philby's time in the Secret Service. Publication of the memoirs was banned by MI6, but after Milne's death in 2010, his family were determined that this insider's account of the Philby affair be published. Edited to include newly released top secret documents showing how the KGB's master spy managed to fool MI6 even after he defected to Moscow, this is the final word on one of the world's most notorious spies by the MI6 colleague who knew him best. The insider account of the Philby affair that Britain's spy chiefs did not want you to read. So the blurb, quite good.
I want to read it now. I just want to read that right now.
It's a good book. Genuinely recommend it. Now, when they say also, this is the final word, of course, Ben McIntyre came out with a book pretty much at the same time.
Yeah.
Called Spy Among Friends, which was, I suppose it was more centred on Nicholas Elliott. So that was sort of friendship as well. He features in it quite a lot. Anyway, in terms of the blurb, what did I actually think of it? Well, firstly, it's important to point out that the book's subtitle is accurate. It does indeed deal with the friendship between them. For instance, the first 60 or so pages mainly deal with their school days and the European holidays that go on together. So if you're expecting a Watson-all insight into Philby's treachery and tradecraft from the get-go, you'll be disappointed. And let's not forget, for many years, despite both working in MI6, you were often apart for years, just periodically catching up with one another. So it's not as if it's a comprehensive, you know, every single day, you know, not you really expect that in a book, but it's not, there are visible, you know, there's obvious gaps in how much you sort of relate about it. But what you do get is Milne's more than qualified opinions on Philby's personal and professional lives. There are some wonderful little insights into the arch traitor. For some reason, Philby hated apples.
Did he? okay, we all have our thing. I don't like oranges, but anyway.
He named his dog Guy after his Cambridge cohort, Guy Burgess. He also named his second son Thomas after Thomas Harris, Tommy Harris, Agent Garbo's handler in the UK's wartime double cross system. Philby initially tried to get Milne into the secret world when he was a political instructor at SOE, the Special Operations Executive, down in Bewley. He didn't get the job in question, but when Philby managed to get back into MI6 and was posted to the counter-espionage section, basically an armed house in St. Albans, he got his man this time. Milne helpfully explains the role of counter-espionage in MI6, and specifically that of Section V. Rather comically, the Iberian subsection they worked in was classified as ZD. This lends itself well to Chinese honey traps earlier on. There's a fair amount of detail here in terms of what the section was working on and the subsequent trials and tribulations. Milne recounts how, with the war going on and the nature of the job, secret files were habitually being carried around by staffers on buses and in pubs before finding themselves in the respective homes of the staff. Again, this doesn't specifically refer to Philby, so some grumpy gits might complain about the lack of Philby specifics here. But actually, it's very interesting stuff. Remember, too, that the generally, sort of well-known books on wartime British intelligence tend to focus either on Bletchley Park or maybe the Double Cross system or elsewhere. So there's no complaints from me here in terms of, you know, this particular focus on the counter-espionage stuff. Milne also has some interesting opinions on the others in and around Philby, such as Tim's wife, Aileen, and Guy Burgess. In fact, Milne gives the opinion that after Aileen, Guy is the most tragic character in this whole story. Almost everything he touched turned into failure in the end. Ouch. Milne reckons that Burgess simply didn't have the nerve required to carry out his role as a penetration agent for the Russians.
Yeah.
Now, as I've just got my my hands on the new Guy Burgess biography written by Andrew Loney, I might be able to add some comment on that. And we will, hopefully, fingers crossed, have Andrew for an interview in the next few weeks. There's no doubt that and shows a great deal of sentiment and thoughtful reflection in recounting his and his family's relationships with the Philbys. And there's objectivity too, while easy to demonise Philby for his real treachery from 1944 when the Nazis were weakened through to 1951, it's apparent that in the Section V years, Philby was regarded as being genuinely good at his job and well regarded by both MI6 and MI5. Mm. But this isn't a book written through rose-tinted glasses, reminiscing about the good old days together. When Philby died in 1988, Milne's daughter wondered whether he had mixed feelings. Mm. Milne replied, "No, for me, he died many years ago." And this is one of the book's strong points. Milne doesn't duck from the more contentious points raised about his friend's treachery, and has obviously thought about them in methodical fashion. In the aftermath of Kim's defection, Milne looks at things as objectively as possible. Mm-hmm. He ponders how Philby managed to spy for Russians during their time together in Section V, given its trips to London were full of meetings and engagements, either at MI6's headquarters in Broadway, and with MI5 in their St. James's Street offices, and so on. There appear to be no glaring gaps in his diary in which he could meet his handlers, so it has to be pretty slick and well orchestrated. Mm. So he looks at the various things objectively, clinically. He also lists the types of intelligence Philby could have passed on to Mother Russia during the Glen Almond years, wondering if he was actually doing the Brits a favour.
I've heard that before, actually, but yeah.
Churchill,
yeah.
And Roosevelt by the Russians could have been alleviated by Philby reassuring his handlers, and therefore Moscow. The common consensus is that Philby did immeasurable damage, but Milne highlights the fact that while Philby was indeed head of MI6's counter-espionage operations against the Russians, he was only in charge of this between 1944 and 1946, hardly the height of the Cold War. After that, he was off to Istanbul for 2 years. Sure, he was head of station there, but the intel was going to be geographically limited in scope. Mm. The big deal was landing the Washington gig in 1949, where he became head of station and the key MI6 liaison between MI6 and the US intelligence community, where if he lasted longer, he could have inflicted far more damage on the West. But it seems that by this time he had to be cautious, considering he now knew about the American-led hunt for the Russian agent Homer, Donald McLean, one of his Cambridge cohorts. Much of his efforts would probably be defensive, trying to protect or being on the lookout for new developments in this matter, rather than indulging himself fully with acquiring nice juicy secrets to pass on to his Russian handlers. There's another key point which made me immediately make a comparison with John le Carré's arch-traitor Bill Hayden in Tinker, Tailor, Soldier, Spy. After Hayden has been discovered and has been questioned by George Smiley, he reveals it was never in the plan for him to become chief of the circus, as MI6 was known. It would have been impractical. You know, he'd have been bogged down with too many meetings to chair, committees to attend, functions to frequent. His appointments diary would have been chock-a-block, leaving him no time to actually meet his handler. Milne arrives at the same separate conclusion with Philby, who had been touted by many as being a potential chief of the service. How would he have been able to slink off somewhere to meet a Russian contact if he was head of MI6? It would have been impossible. Also, if he was chief, he wouldn't have had the same level of operational secrets of interest to the Russians. So while he potentially could have become a significant agent of influence in the highest levels of British intelligence machinery if he was chief, operationally, he would have lost a great deal of effectiveness. So the nightmare scenario painted by many of Philby as MI6 chief, a fallacy, Milne suggests. And as he correctly maintains, with several highly respected figures in the MI6 management structure, there was no guarantee Philby would be chief anyway. So in summary, when all said and done, would I recommend it? Yes, I would. It's a good book, and if you're interested in Philby and you also want an appreciation of what it was like working in MI6 during the war, it's very good. Personally, I wasn't too bothered about the first couple of chapters that focused on their adolescence and their earlier days. But neither did I get the feeling it was just filler material to pad the book more. As said earlier, Milne's book isn't the only recent one concerned with Philby. Ben McIntyre's written The Spy Among Our Friends, and I actually remember a Radio 4 interview a while ago with Ben McIntyre and Michael Smith. Obviously, it's, commissioning editor, I think, at Byteback, the publishers, and they were debating Philby from the respective positions. It was quite an interesting little sort of to and fro. I've downloaded McIntyre's book on Audible, so I'm listening to that currently. It does seem a good book. But finally, draw things to close, a couple of, some juicy little snippets that I picked up from the book. Apparently, Philby's mum was apparently a bit of a looker, at least according to Milne. Now, we also, you may have heard of a chap called John Walker, who caused the US Navy a whole amount of trouble by, spying pretty much for money for the Russians. And it was actually, the story was dramatized and made into a TV sort of miniseries called Family of Spies. And I think he got his, his son, he got him into the US Navy. He started spying for him as well. And the whole pretty much family is involved in it. Well, it was almost like this with Milne, not in terms of treachery, but in terms of a family. They were involved in MI5, SOE, the American OSS. And that was just Milne's family. What I also learned was that Philby's younger sister also got into it. Helena Philby joined Section V in 1943. Two last points. Tim Milne reckons that Philby's first marriage to Lizzie Friedman, she was the communist who they met in Vienna, and he then got her out back to London, and they married. Milne doesn't think it had anything to do with recruitment by the Russians. So that's, that's very often sort of touted about in some various books. But Milne certainly doesn't think it had anything, there's no sort of subterfuge involved there. And finally, again, we're coming back to a little bit of sex. Another little snippet. Diplomatic intercepts were called BJs. There we go. Finishing BJs, things on the
very my word. It really is a diplomatic intercept, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh my word.
But there we go. Had to finish on a very sort of very sort of high point there.
Yeah.
But no, it's a good book to read. So if you are sort of interested in Philby, and also I think the wartime sort of counter-espionage thing, which I'd say, most people when it's wartime, it's either Bletchley Park or it's Double Cross or whatever. It was genuinely interesting.
Yeah. No, that's good. That's good.
Well worth a read.
Definitely. Have you ever seen, just quick question, have you ever seen the BBC drama Cambridge Spies?
No, I haven't.
I would recommend it, just because as you talk about this, because it goes into their early life. I don't know how accurate it is, but it was very entertaining. And Tom Hollander played Guy Burgess. And I think he does it beautifully. But anyway, and Kim Philby was played by Toby Stevens, who was the Bond villain in Die Another Day, which wasn't a brilliant Bond movie, which will help us segue into Bond. So, because we now have...
I couldn't have done it better myself.
So we have Spectre, of my best Sean Connery accent possible. So Spectre, the new Bond movie. Spectre, yes. You can probably do it better because you've got the natural accent for Sean Connery. Yes. But... I will try and keep this spoiler-free. I won't keep it opinion-free, but the official synopsis from IMDb is a cryptic message from Bond's past sends him on a trail to uncover a sinister organisation. While M battles political forces to keep the Secret Service alive, Bond peels back the layers of deceit to reveal the terrible truth behind Spectre. So, there we go. So, I suppose with Bond films, I think is usually the people who like Bond films fall into two categories of kind of films they like. I like the ones that feel more grounded, so like From Russia with Love, License to Kill, and obviously Casino Royale. Sorry, how am I messing Casino Royale? Because Casino Royale for me is like one of my favourite Bond movies. I think for me it's From Russia with Love, then Casino Royale, because I think Casino Royale is a really good movie. It has a good villain, the villain has a good story, it's got great action, it feels real, it's got the Bond elements in it, but they're not over the top, they're not like in your face Bond elements, they're just little subtle nods here and there and stuff like that. When Skyfall came out, they were ramping up the Bond elements, and so we had like in jokes about like Bond's gadgets and things like that, and it's like, well, we, you know, we don't do exploding watches anymore, we just give you this transmitter and a signature pistol, which I think the scene was better than that, but anyway, it was on those lines. Now in Spectre kind of, to me, feels like James Bond's greatest hits replayed for you. A bit like the terrible Terminator Genesis, but Spectre's not as bad as Terminator Genesis by any means. But Terminator Genesis was terrible. But that's a different film.
I've not seen that.
Oh, so my God.
Yeah, I think that'll be one I'll have to look at.
Film sadly just failed on so many levels. But the main problem, the main failure of Terminator Genesis was the fact that it was too caught up in trying to redo and then reinvent action scenes that we'd seen in the previous films. And Spectre falls into this trap. And so most of the stuff that you see in the film, you kind of feel like, oh yeah, I've seen that in other Bond movies. And as a Bond geek, it is kind of partly fun trying to spot all the references. You know, like, oh, that's Living Daylights. Oh, that's this, there's that. You know, and there are a lot of Bond references in this film. But the story lacks any real stakes. The villain, Oberhauser, is not particularly villainous in his actions. He certainly, you know, is definitely the head of an organization that is very similar to Quantum from Quantum of Solace. It's basically Spectre is the rebranding of Quantum, and they've updated their logo, and they're still having covert meetings. And Quantum of Solace, which was not a great Bond movie, but at the same time, I felt was actually had more memorable moments than Spectre did. Because at least Quantum of Solace was trying to be an authentic, kind of genuine, sort of original film. And like the sequence where Bond discovers Quantum in Quantum of Solace at the opera is amazing. That's probably the best bit of the whole film.
I think that is a fantastic... I mean, yeah. As you say, Solace, I sometimes felt that it was like, if you added 45 minutes... onto the back of Casino Royale, that would have been Quantum of Solace.
Yeah.
You know, like that.
Yeah.
But there are particular bits of Solace which I reckon are as frustrating as anything.
Yeah.
And that whole thing with the opera, particularly, I'm a bit of a soundtrack sort of the music accompanying that whole sort of, it's just brilliant.
Isn't it? And that gunfight with the...
Well done.
Yeah, and the gunfight with the music wrapped up, and you've got no audio, but just the music, and this... That was brilliant.
Very
and stylish. Yeah, and Quantum of Spectre lacks all that kind of visionary stuff. It just doesn't have anything really to say. And it does have this B plot going on that's an obvious comment to what we've been talking about today about the increase of surveillance. And as I was saying earlier, this film pretty much says old school spying good, electronic surveillance bad. So MI6 and MI5 are going through a merger. And they're about to become a new organisation. And the head of that new organisation will be known as C. Now, that's an interesting reference, because the head of MI6 is known as C. Because the first head of MI6 was Lord Mansfield Cumming. And so he signed off as C, and that kind of stuck. So anyway, the best line of the whole movie comes from Ralph Fiennes, when he and C have a confrontation of sorts. I'm trying not to spoil it here. And then he says, oh, so that's what C stands for. And that was the best line in the whole film. That is probably the most original bit in the whole movie. Beyond that, it just wasn't great. I liked the music. I thought the performances, everybody was doing a good job acting-wise. You know, the cinematography is great. The opening is good. I suppose, if anything... backtracking my, it's not anything original in it. I suppose the opening was probably the most original thing, but in a way, this whole long tracking shot thing, it has its roots in films like Touch of Evil and recently Birdman. And it's becoming a bit trendy right now to do these like long shots or entire films that feel like one long shot. So in a way, I think Sam Mendes is cashing in on that trend right now. Bless him. It was enjoyable. I mean, I sat there, I was enjoying it. It's the third act for me where I really came out of it, and then I became really cynical about it. Up until that moment, I was just on the surface enjoying it and having a good time. It's a great Saturday night movie. It won't change your life. Most Bond films never will, but it's good fun. But it's just not the best Bond movie. So I out of my personal rating, so I put Casino Royale as a 5-star Bond movie. This is a 3-star Bond movie. It's not a 2, and it's definitely not a 4 or a 5. So I'm amazed by the 5-star reviews. And I know our lady earlier, that Guardian journalist, believes it's a conspiracy that these 5-star ratings because of the Investigatory Powers Act. But I'm not convinced by that. But certainly a lot of people seem to love this film. Fair enough. It's good. I hope if you haven't seen it, do check it out. It's well worth watching. Do always support Bond movies, because if you don't support movies you like, they won't make them anymore. So, so go out and support it, please.
I thought it was a good one. I remember when it was like the late 90s. When a Bond film came out. You know, I never used to go to the cinema to see, you know, Bond films come out. Mm. You'd wait for the Queen's speech at 3 o'clock on ITV or something on Christmas Day, and oh, there's your Bond film, a bygone era. But I think probably the first one I saw, it was GoldenEye. That was the first time I went to see a Bond film, cinema, and
that's got a great opening.
That was 95.
Yeah,
I wasn't impressed with, mainly because I absolutely hated the soundtrack. Mm. I thought it was...
Ugh. It was Gregory Sierra off the top of my... No, was that the guy? That's the guy at Miami Vice, what I'm on about. It's somebody Sierra, but not Gregory Sierra. Anyway, sorry.
The next one, Tomorrow Never Dies.
Yeah.
I went to see that at the cinema 3 times.
Mm.
I just had some different friends who, you know, said, oh, I've not seen the Bond film. And I thought it was a good film.
Mm.
So I thought, yeah, I'll go back and see it. So it wasn't like anything like, you know, absolutely, you know, thinking this is the best movie, you know, in all my life. But just, I thought it was a really good film. And I had no issues with going back to see it a second or a third time. Despite, I think, there was a lot of problems in shooting the film, in terms of the director, in terms of actors. Mm. I think I heard somewhere that it wasn't the smoothest of films to make, but I thought it was, you know, certainly one of the better ones in Pierce Brosnan's time. But I think the Daniel Craig ones have really been a notch above, and that's not to you know, speak cruelly of any of the others.
Mm.
But I mean, you'll know yourself, there's a lot to making a good film and just a good actor. Yeah. There's so many variables involved, and sometimes that mix works. Mm. Sometimes it can just be one of those aspects which doesn't work, which is the difference between a good film and a...
With Casino Royale, they had a great book as a basis. They had a brilliant writer, which was Paul Haggis. And he was the creator of Juice Out, if you remember that show. And he went on to write the Oscar-winning Crash. It's just Casino Royale. I rewatched it the other day because my wife had this James Bond evening at her work, and they had to vote which Bond movie to watch, and they all voted for Casino Royale. It's just so well written. It's just got all the elements. Like that scene where Bond meets Vesper Lynn for the first time is brilliant. That bit went on the train, and like, I just love that scene. And he's got all the Bond charm, the jokes, everything about it being too much. And I just think with the recent one, it's just they've just got a bit too caught up in being a Bond movie. Because I think with Daniel Craig's era, the first one was they were just resetting the clock. And I think, you know, Daniel Craig was very conscious, just trying to do the best job he could, because he had a lot of criticism for being blonde. So it's like that was all going on. With the second film, they had a few problems, and I think the second film was too self-conscious. It was too desperately trying not to be a Bond movie. And it went a bit... I felt it was trying to be more Jason Bourne. It was trying to be a lot more things. It was trying its very best to not be James Bond and, like, cut all the gadgets, anything. And it suffered from not having a fully developed script because of the writer's strike as well. Yeah. So I think... And that film always feels like a missed opportunity. I walked out of the cinema very frustrated. It's actually one of the shortest Bond movies, but it just didn't quite work. And the editing's a bit frustrating too. Like that, there's a famous shot. They're actually pastiching the Goldfinger moment, and the way that scene is edited, they kind of just totally make a balls up of it, and so it loses its impact. And the way they structured which shot to go first, and so on, in my opinion, it wasn't. it had a lot of good elements. Like, I love the Felix Leiter story in that one, because he's battling with his conscience about the COA's relationship with Dominic Green, isn't it? Is that the name of the villain?
Yeah.
And the whole water thing that's going on, which I still don't fully understand, but he's buying up a lot of land that has a lot of water in it, and I think the idea is he's going to, because he owns the water, you'll be able to charge for it or whatever. So why Quantum and Spectre are that bothered, I don't know, but they are. I guess there's money to be made. Then with Skyfall and Spectre, the other way, they've gone too Bond and a bit too, oh, we're a Bond movie, woo, you know, and like showing all these references and stuff like that. And, oh, wow, he's driving this car now, he's doing that. I think in Skyfall, it held better together, those bits. I like the use of James Bond's car at the end at Skyfall itself, you know. That was quite a cool little moment. But with, just with Spectre, they went too far with it, I think. And I just think it for me, felt like the writers were just sat watching the Bond, the 50th anniversary Bond DVD collection on the loop, and just like, oh, a bit of that, bit of that, bit of that, and mixing it together. But who knows? It's not as, from experience, it's not easy to write anything. And, maybe next year, when you see my film finally comes out, you'll know whether I was successful or not. But it's not easy writing. It's very hard. To do a Bond movie, that's a big job. And hats off to anybody who's done it, because I have no idea how you could sometimes. It's a very fine line with Bond trying to, because I always like Bond films to be a genuine thriller that Bond happens to be the protagonist of, and that's quite hard to pull off, I think. And for me, like License to Kill with Timothy Dalton, I thought was a great movie. It just suffers from being a bit 80s. It's got some moments in it like, oh my God. But Casino Royale is the perfect balance. I love From Russia with Love. That is my hands down favourite Bond movie, and it's got Sean Connery, yes, my favourite James Bond. So, Mish Moneypenny. It's hard. But Daniel Craig's been an amazing Bond. I think this film wraps him up nicely if he wants to, but I've heard rumour that it could be part of a two-part story, but then I've read denials of that too, so who knows? He may be back, he may not be, but if he's not back, they can do what they did in Goldeneye. There was a trailer, one of the early Goldeneye trailers, where Pierce Brosnan appears and he sort of says, "Were you expecting someone else?" So whoever the next James Bond is, at least could use that line.
It's a good, film. Very, very easy to watch. Some of the, especially the opening, the whole sort of opening little bit, very stylish. Filmed wonderfully. I mean, the whole sort of carnival of the dead.
That bit's great.
It must have been like a costume designer's dream. Getting all that sorted out. Visually very.
And also the helicopter work in that sequence, amazing too. I mean, there's definitely some bits where I think there was some computer graphics involved. There's one bit where it obviously is involved.
There was one bit where I thought, just doesn't look quite right.
Did you get that Heineken advert before the movie where James Bond's in a boat?
Yeah.
Now, the green screen in the helicopter sequence was as bad as that boat sequence in that advert. The advert may have done it slightly better. Bless.
But do you think, this is the thing, almost like the sack that intern sort of red mist from earlier. Do you think when they get back into the editing room or whatever, that they see that and just don't really sort of focus on it? Or they do and think, we can't do anything about it. No, just carry on.
I think it's a combination of factors. I think some of it's down to, because that's the compositing. So it's when you overlay the one image into another. And it's a real skill. And some people have a good eye for it, some people don't. And I think what it is, it's my opinion here, I think that people who are very computer graphics based as their point of reference don't notice those problems. But people who have come from more of a photography and art background tend to notice it more. Also, there's time and budget constraints too on top of all that. And I think with a Bond movie, they started filming in December last year. So they have 6 months to shoot it. and only a few months to edit the thing. So they're editing as they're filming. And then they had to do all the special effects work. And special effects work is quite long-winded, complicated. There's a lot of factors that go into it, make it good and bad. And so it's a combination of factors. But I would always... My feeling is usually it's down to the compositor and whether they have a good eye for it or not. But then so many people see these films. You do wonder sometimes, has nobody else noticed it? And the funny thing is, well, with... sorry, I'm going off a bit of a tangent now, but... Like, LED televisions, the image quality on a lot of TVs today is abysmal. And it's amazing how these TVs have really taken off. I still find the old school televisions, the CRT, the tube type televisions, provide a much better image than any of the top end high definition TVs around at the moment. And it's so it has our tastes aesthetically changed as well. I don't know. Anyway, food for thought.
That's an interesting way to sort of, you know, question for you to ponder over the weekend.
Yeah,
the
week. Exactly.
TV, crap.
Yeah. Oh, man. I think we probably should wrap up because I've noticed we're at 1 hour and 41 minutes.
We've crammed in quite a bit.
We have.
next Sunday evening. If we've not already put you off, no, we haven't. Of course, you've enjoyed every minute of it. We will have more of the news. I suspect it will probably be slightly shorter than tonight's version. I'm sure that IPA will be covered a little bit, but we'll try and if there are other aspects of the intelligence world, specifically, mostly from a British perspective. But not exclusively so. That do sort of come up. We will sort of try and and bring those to you. It's not just going to be the IPA sort of debate that's going to take up all of the news. So at least that's wishful thinking.
Yeah. Sometimes it's hard. There's always a story that tends to dominate things, isn't there? There will be something. Next week it might be more Chinese sexual scandals. There might be something comes out. Maybe David Cameron's been caught out in China or something. Who knows? I don't know that. I'm just saying that. I'm speculating.
There's something I'm dying to add to that, but I think the lawyers would have a field
day. Yeah.
No.
Anyway.
No, Brian, don't. Right. So there's that. In terms of... you should really be thinking about another film to review or talk about.
I know, or TV. I don't know. I mean, there's a few things I've been watching lately that definitely are spiralized to be worth looking at. I've really enjoyed Sean Bean's show called Legends that could be worth talking about because I think the second series is starting in America at the moment, so it could be a good time to visit the first series if you haven't seen it.
Tell us all, what's Legends about?
So Legends is about an undercover agent for the FBI, and what the way this is slightly different from other ones is he kind of takes on the persona of the person and starts to really believe it. It's a really interesting, fun show. It's 24 meets the Manchurian Candidate.
Oh, wow. I mean, you just sold it like that.
That's Legend. So it's like, it's not the best TV in the world, but it's not the worst either. It's great fun, so I definitely recommend that one. I'll talk about that next week if you like.
There was also, actually, one thing I remember, if you've been watching in Britain, there was a TV show recently just finished called Hunted.
Oh, yes. We could talk about that next week a bit.
Or was it Wanted? No, it was Hunted.
Hunted, because there was a show called Wanted, but that's another story.
A show called Hunted, and the premise is, this was, maybe it was, almost like leading us up to the IPA, but we're really sort of taking a look at, the powers of the state, and if you were sort of, how far, pretty much, how long could you survive, on your Todd, on your own, or with somebody, when you had all the powers of the state, supposedly, on your case. So they had a whole bunch of, couples who were doing their, doing their bit. Actually, some were couples, some were just individuals.
Yeah.
And this ran for, was it 6 weeks or so?
Yeah.
And it was good entertaining telly. But then recently I started having a conversation about, okay, so if we were doing this, how would we do it better? Or what were the factors that maybe determined whether certain people got caught, whether certain people succeeded, that sort of thing. So I think, either next week or maybe the week after,
we'll talk about that.
I'll have a toss up group, because we'll go into that a bit more, detail.
Cool.
That'll be an eventful one. So if you think we went overboard on the IPA news today, then you've heard nothing yet compared to Hunted next week, week after. From a book point of view, I am either probably going to get my head around the new Guy Burgess biography written by Andrew Loney, or still be marked to Ben McIntyre's book called A Spy Among Friends. But as I said, given that the Burgess biography is hot off the press, and Andrew Loney himself said it's been it's going to be getting reprinted, so it's obviously doing well. So it makes more sense to try and focus on that. So assuming I've had time, I will try and do my level best to get a review of that. And Mr. Loney himself, we may be able to catch him for a little interview as well. He seems quite keen on that.
Cool.
And I think we've got one or two other authors potentially lined up, certainly before Christmas, to talk about some releases of theirs. So it's, from a book review point of view, it's looking quite good.
I think we've got definitely some ideas and some interesting guests to get in over the next few months. Whether they're part of this show or separate shows that we'll produce for it as well. So I'll say thank you so much to everybody who has actually endured and listened to us this evening, or whenever you do listen to it. No, not necessarily be the evening, but it's been great fun. Thank you. And, thank you, Brian, for the chat. It's been great. It's been really, I've really enjoyed it today. It's been really good.
So if you want to catch up with us, you can do on Twitter. There is Spies Shadows TV. You can also get a hold of us on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing, Spies Shadows TV. And the website will be coming up in the next couple of weeks, where you'll be able to get the podcast. And things like the book reviews, we'll probably have those as separate features as well. So if you just want the book reviews, as we get more and more of them, then you can just look at those individual reviews, either visually on the website, or listen to it's a separate audio file. First and foremost, this will be on YouTube. That's the first protocol. But then, as you get the website up and running, then you'll find all the bits and bobs and assorted gubbins there as well. If you've got any comments, by all means, harangue us on Twitter and Facebook.
Well,
and,
politely message us, don't harangue us. There's so many arguments people get into. I'm going to try and avoid any Facebook arguments.
But yeah, by all means, get in touch with us on social media. We'd love to hear your comments about it, and things that you'd like to hear, maybe perhaps covered as well. We're open to that as well. So as Chris said, thanks very much for listening to us, and I hope it's provided food for thought, and enjoy your week. Cheerio.
Thank you, everybody.
Five. 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 Five.